We were left on a Bren gun post at the bottom of this hill in the cemetery, and the orders were to stay there until the last bullet had gone and then make our way up the top. Well, the Japanese, we could hear them screaming and shouting, and some of them were shouting in English, you know, Tommy, tonight you die, if you ever heard anything like it. So I let fire with a Bren gun carrier, and I think I could safely say that the barrel was white hot when there was no more ammunition. We had to go. So we said run, and we ran from tombstone to tombstone up this hill when Jimmy was hit, and his face, I thought half his face had gone. And I got him up the top, covered in blood. I wasn't hit at that stage. And I never saw Jimmy Kiss again until after the war. He was taken away, obviously, over the hill to an ambulance depot. And that's a very interesting story I'll pick up later on. Three other of my mates, when we went back after capitulation, we had to bury them. One of them actually had his bayonet through a Jap, and somebody had bayoneted him in the back. We had to bury all of them. And it was a horrific situation. Well, we got up to the top where our colonel was, and we had to withdraw into the streets of Singapore, actually in the streets. And they had these big malarial drains, and I was hit. I had a small wound, and my hands were bleeding. I don't know what hit me, but something was a bit uncomfortable. And there was nothing could be done about it. And I was actually captured in the early hours of the morning of February the 15th, 1942. There was about eight of us lying in this malarial gutter. And a Japanese tank, and people said they didn't have tanks, but they did have tanks, came down, and he spluttered machine gun all one side where some of our men were screaming. One young lad got up, and he ran across the road, obviously to try to get to our side, and he was literally cut in half. His body departed in front of us. It just fountains of blood. Another one had decapitated at the time. Terrific business. And the Jap tank paused at the end of the road, swung around, and then we thought, well, this is it. It's going to do our side. And an officer that was with us with a peculiar name of Captain Weistock Crundall, don't know where he got it, he had a walking stick, and he put a white handkerchief on and held it up, and to our utter amazement, this tank stopped a few feet, the turret opened, and a voice said in perfect English, "Get out, put your hands up and stand in front of the tank," which of course we did. And that's how I was actually captured. Then we were taken back behind the Japanese lines, and our own guys were shelling us from the beach there. And it was a very uncomfortable experience, because the Japanese seemed to think that we were Americans and not British. And they asked the questions, and I had an interpreter came, he sort of said, under fire. We were back on the golf course in Japanese hands on the morning of the 15th of February 1942. And I said, no. He said to me, British? I said, we are British. I said, name, rank and number. So I said, my name, Ernest Warwick, 6019289. And that was it. Give no more information. And this guy said, well, we know you're Americans. You came in on American ships. You're Americans and you're lying. You belong to America. And I said, no, we're British. What unit you're in? Don't know. And then he said, well, we're going to execute you one at a time. And they meant business. They weren't playing movies. And why they picked on me, I don't know. Probably because I was the ugliest looking guy there, you know. And he said, we'll start with you. He said, until you tell us what unit you were in. And at that moment, I think my life was saved by about 15 seconds, because it was now, time was going on, it was now in the evening, and they had a little small radio van, one would say, and they obviously were receiving message from Yamashita, their commander-in-chief, and they came out shouting, just as this firing squad put their guns up, and I must confess, I did feel very frightened, but I thought to myself, well, I'll make a run for it. I would never have got away. I thought I'd dive and run, but they would have got me anyway. And at that moment, this Japanese officer shouting, waving their hands in there, and I couldn't understand. The interpreter came over and he stood in front of me. He said, you're a very lucky man. He said, your commander-in-chief, General Percival, has surrendered the island of Singapore to us as from now, and you are honourable Japanese prisoners of war. Of course, we first encountered the Japanese guards, and of course, many of them obviously couldn't speak English at all, which was a good thing, the way we were swearing and carrying on. But some Japanese officers could speak quite good English, and there were interpreters and Malay interpreters there, so that wasn't a great problem. The biggest problem was that we had to bury the dead. There were dead Singapore was a sad place in 1942. The streets ran with blood. There were notices in English, Malay and Chinese, bury your dead here. There were women and children. When we got into the city, there was no water in the city, no electricity. You could well understand why Percival, without air support, left. On February the 10th, 1942, General Wavell came to the island of Singapore, and he issued the order of the day from Sir Winston Churchill, was then Winston Churchill in London, our Prime Minister, that every man should fight to the last man, to the last bullet. And the officers were expected to die with their men in the streets, and regardless of women and children who would also die, this famous city must be held, Singapore. Well, you know, that's all right for Mr. Churchill, 12,000 miles away in London in his underground bunker. It was a very different situation in Singapore, with 1 million people being slaughtered hourly by the Japanese from the air, and us not having any air support. And when the Australian Commander-in-Chief received the message, I understand it's in history that he tore it in little pieces and said something very rude, which I won't repeat at the moment. And it's interesting to note that General Wavell, one of the Australian generals, on the 10th of February, the same day, promptly got on the last aircraft and flew out to Australia from Singapore, or the last ship, whatever the case. It is a fact in history. And I thought, well, having delivered that and left us to our fate, that was the way it was, you see. So I just wanted to put that on record. Now we come back to our task. Our main task was to bury the dead in the gardens, our own dead. We went back over the battlefield, over the golf course, this beautiful golf course cemetery, found mates we knew, Australians, British, men from Southend that I won't name because of their relations, you know. And yes, that was very shattering. We also had to bury the Japanese dead. Then we were rounded up and we had to march from the capital city of Singapore to the area called Changi, which was about 15, 16 miles away, where chaos reigned supreme. That was our first initial area. We were all rounded into Changi. Thousands and thousands and thousands, wounded, dead and dying. And it would be difficult, Terry, to relate to you how the city of Singapore looked in those days. I understand it's like Hong Kong today. I'd love to go there. But then it was so sad, the devastation, the bomb damage, and the way they were carrying on was unbelievable. The horrors of war have to be seen to be believed, and it will remain with me till I die, one of the terrible memories. It must seem, I suppose, all these years on to younger people like yourselves reading history and thinking about it, how on earth did most people believe that Singapore was a fortress, and we called it the fortress that never was. Russell Braddon, the famous Australian author who wrote The Naked Island, it was a naked island. The only people that fooled were our own people, because the Japs obviously weren't fooled. They knew all about it. They got it well weighed up before. They had people working in the banks. They had already officers, Japanese officers in civilian jobs waiting. They knew. It was a walkover as far as they were concerned. They said, well, they got no aircraft. They're on their knees. They haven't got enough troops. Of course, and then we threw in all these other troops. But I still, to this day, I don't know the real reasons why it was seemed so silly, so unbelievably stupid that, and I repeat myself, that the War Office, the Foreign Office, our intelligence service must have known all of these things. They must have known we haven't got a hope in hell of holding the island of Singapore, and it was not a fortress. And why they led the world to believe it was a fortress and then climbed down and said this wonderful fortress has been captured, it's a load of rubbish. It was the naked island, as Russell Braddon said. It was the fortress that never was. That's the only way I could describe it. It was a terrible disillusion. We hadn't a hope in hell. And without modern aircraft, as been proved in the Gulf, if you want to win a battle, you've got to have air supremacy. We had it the other way around. We hadn't any. And that's the key to the whole thing. Plus the fact, as you rightly say in your question, was it a fortress? It was just a luxury island.